performateur for musical theater, and I want to invite you, I want to welcome you to Grace Senior Recital. One thing that it's important to do is to turn your phone off, please, everyone. We're making some good headway, I think, in disconnecting from this while we perform, which is really good. So we're asking you as an audience to do the same. Gray. What can I say about Gray? Gray is kind of remarkable. She came to us from South Dakota. She was a summer audition for us, May or June, I feel like it was. And here was someone who was very talented as a singer, an actor, and a dancer, but surprisingly was not passionate about musical theater per se as much as she was passionate about the things that we do, right? So it's been really, she's laughing, it's been really fun to watch her like fall in love with particular shows or material, because that wasn't really the way that she came into the program. But in terms of someone who flourished as an actor and a singer and a dancer, it's hard to imagine someone who's a better example of what like hard work and training and bringing that passion eventually really does. So I'm really excited to bring you Gray Cercil Williamson.
White, a blank page or canvas. The challenge, bring order to the whole. Through design. Composition. Balance. Light. And harmony. Everyone is wearing them.
Everyone.
You know they are.
Could you drop your head a little, please?
I read they're even wearing them in America.
They are fighting the Indians in America, and you cannot read.
I can read. A little. Why did we have to get up so early?
The light.
Oh.
Ugh.
What's the matter?
I hate this tree.
I thought you were drawing me.
I am. Just stand still. Drop your head a little, please. Stop. If you wish to be a good model, you must learn to concentrate. Hold the pose. Look out at the water. More boats. More trees.
George! You always get to sit in the shade, while I have to stand in the sun. George. Hello, George. There is someone in this dress. A trickle of sweat. The back of the head. He always does this. Now the foot is dead. Sunday in the park with George. Is damp, beginning to pinch, the bustle slipping, I won't budge one inch. Who was at the zoo, George? Who was at the zoo? The monkeys and who, George? instead, when you're dead, some more public and more permanent expression of affection. You want a painter, poet, sculptor, preferably marble, granite, bronze, durable. Something nice with swans that's durable forever.
By this time.
You've come here to sell me Robert Chilton's letter, haven't you?
To offer it to you on conditions. How did you guess that?
Because you haven't mentioned the subject. Have you got it with you?
Oh no, a well-made dress has no pockets.
What is your price for it?
How absurdly English you are. The English think that every problem can be solved with a checkbook. My dear Arthur, I have very much more money than you have, and quite as much as Robert Chilton has got hold of. Money is not what I want.
What do you want then, Miss Cheeley?
Why don't you call me Laura?
I don't like the name.
You used to adore it.
Yes, that's why.
Arthur, you loved me once.
Yes.
And you asked me to marry you.
That was the natural result of my loving you.
And you threw me over because you saw, or said you saw, poor old Lord Mortlake trying to have a violent flirtation with me in the conservatory at Tenby. At that time, I was poor. You were rich.
Yes, that is why you pretended to love me.
Poor old Lord Mortlake was never anything more to me than an amusement. One of those utterly tedious amusements one only finds at an English country Sunday. I don't think anybody at all morally responsible for what he or she does on an English country Sunday.
Yes, I know lots of people think that.
I loved you, Arthur.
My dear Mrs. Cheeley, you have always been far too clever to know anything about love.
I did love you, and you loved me. You know you loved me, and love is a very wonderful thing. I suppose that when a man has once loved a woman, he will do anything for her. Except continue to love her.
Yes, except that.
I am tired of living abroad. I want to come back to London. Besides, I have arrived at the romantic stage. When I saw you last night at the Chilterns, I knew you were the only person I've ever cared for, if I've ever cared for anybody, Arthur. And so, on the morning of the day you marry me, I will give you Robert Chilton's letter. That is my offer. I will give it to you now, if you promise to marry me.
Now?
Tomorrow.
Are you really serious?
Yes, quite serious.
I should make you a terrible husband.
I don't mind terrible husbands. I've had two. They amused me immensely.
You mean that you amused yourself immensely, don't you?
What do you know about my married life?
Nothing, but I can read it like a book.
What book?
The Book of Numbers.
Do you think it is quite charming of you to be so rude to a woman in your own house?
In the case of fascinating women, sex is a challenge, not a defense.
I suppose it is meant for a compliment. My dear Arthur, women are never disarmed by compliments. Men always are. That is the difference between the two sexes.
Women are never disarmed by anything, as far as I know.
Then you are going to allow your greatest friend, Robert Chilton, to be ruined, rather than marry someone who really has considerable attractions left. I thought you would have risen to some great height of self-sacrifice, Arthur. I think you should. In the rest of your life, you could spend in contemplating your own perfections.
Oh, I do that as it is. And self-sacrifice is a thing that should be put down by law. It is so demoralizing to the people for whom one sacrifices oneself. They always go to the bad.
As if anything could demoralize Robert Chilton, you seem to forget that I know his real character.
What you know about him is not his real character. It was an act of folly done in his youth. Dishonorable? I admit. Shameful? I admit. Unworthy of him? I admit. And therefore not his true character.
How you men stand up for each other.
How you women war against each other.
I only war against one woman. Against Gertrude Chilton. I hate her. I hate her now more than ever.
Because you have brought a real tragedy into her life, I suppose.
Oh, there is only one real tragedy in a woman's life. The fact that her past is always her lover, and her future invariably her husband. Well, Arthur, I suppose that this romantic interview may be regarded as at an end. You admit it was romantic, don't you? For the privilege of being your wife, I was ready to make a great sacrifice, the climax of my diplomatic career. You decline. Very well. If Sir Robert doesn't uphold my Argentine scheme, I expose him. Voila tout.
You mustn't do that. It would be vile, horrible, infamous.
Oh, don't use such big words. They mean so little. It is a commercial transaction, that's all. There is no use in mixing up sentimentality in it. I offer to Sir Robert Chilton a certain thing. If he won't pay me my price, he will have to pay the world a greater price. There's nothing more to be said. I must go. Goodbye. Won't you shake hands?
With you? No. Your transaction with Robert Chilton may pass as a loathsome commercial transaction, of a loathsome commercial age, but you seem to have forgotten that you came here tonight to speak of love. You, whose lips desecrated the word love, went this afternoon to one of the most noble and gentle women in the world to degrade her husband in her eyes, to kill her love for him, and it may very well be to spoil her soul. That I cannot forgive you, for that there can be no forgiveness.
Arthur, you are unjust to me. Believe me, you are quite unjust to me. I intended of doing nothing of the kind when I entered. I called with Lady Markby simply to ask whether an ornament, a jewel of mine, that I lost at the Chilterns last night had been found. I called, a little out of malice, if you like, but really to ask whether a diamond brooch of mine had been found. That was the origin of the whole thing.
A diamond snake brooch with a ruby?
Yes, how do you know?
Because it is found. In point of fact, I found it myself. It is in this drawer. No, that one. This is the brooch, isn't it?
Yes! I am so glad to get it back. It was a present.
Don't you wear it?
Certainly, if you think it is. Why do you put it on as a bracelet? I never knew it could be worn as a bracelet.
Really?
No, but it looks very well on me as a bracelet, doesn't it?
Yes. Much better than when I saw it last.
When did you see it last?
Oh, 10 years ago, on Lady Berkshire, from whom you stole it.
What do you mean?
I mean that you stole that woman from my cousin, Mary Berkshire, to whom I gave it when she was married. I determined to say nothing until I had found the thief. I have found the thief now, and I have heard her own confession.
It is not true.
No, it is true. Why, thief is written across your face at this moment.
I will deny the whole affair from beginning to end. I will say that I have never seen this wretched thing, and that it was never in my possession.
The drawback of stealing a thing, Mrs. Cheveley, is that one never knows how wonderful the thing is that one steals. You cannot open that bracelet unless you know where the spring is. And I see that you don't know where the spring is. It's rather difficult to find.
You brute! You coward!
Oh, don't use such big words. They mean so little.
What are you going to do?
I'm going to ring for my servant. He is an admirable servant. Always comes the moment one rings for him. I'm going to tell him to fetch the police.
Don't do that. I will do anything you want, anything in the world that you want.
Give me Robert Chilton's letter.
Stop! Let me have time to think.
Give me Robert Chilton's letter.
I have not got it with me. I will give it to you tomorrow.
You know you are lying. Give it to me at once. This is it?
Yes.
For so well dressed a woman, Mrs. Cheveley, you can have admirable moments of common sense.
Thanks. I'm never going to try and harm Robert Chilton again.
Fortunately, you have had the chance, Mrs. Cheveley.
Even if I had the chance, I wouldn't. On the contrary, I'm going to render him a great service.
I'm charmed to hear it. It is a reformation.
And I couldn't bear so upright a gentleman, so honourable a gentleman, being so shamefully deceived, and so...
Well...
I find that somehow Gertrude Chilton's dying speech and confession has strayed into my pocket.
What do you mean?
I mean that I am going to send Robert Chilton the love letter that his wife wrote to you tonight.
The love letter?
Dear Arthur, I want you. I trust you. I am coming to you, Gertrude.
You wretched woman, must you always be thieving? Give it to me at once. I will take it from you by force if I must. You shall not leave this room until I have that letter.
Lord Warren, may I arrange that you should show him out. Good evening, Lord Warren. Worth upon this earth, I didn't care. have ever met within our democracy. I hate the most the athlete with his manner bold and brassy. He may have hair upon his chest, but sister, so has Lassie. Oh, I hate men. I hate men. The roosters say I will not play the hen. Avoid the traveling salesman, though a tempting Tommy may be. From China he will bring you jade and perfume from Arabia. But don't forget 'tis he who'll have the fun and ye the baby. Oh, I hate men. If thou should wedst a businessman, beware, you'll be wary. He'll tell you he's detained in town on business necessary. The business is the business which he gives his secretary.
I'm proud of you.